For decades, the Brit Awards have celebrated the most influential artists in British culture, rewarding musicians whose writing, recording and performances have set them apart. Now the Brits have a brand new award. Tonight, for the first time ever, we're celebrating a Brit icon.
He's not an icon, who is?
He is a global superstar.
Elton John has changed the course of music history.
He's one of the biggest exports that we have.
This is music that will stand the test of time.
He just is the real deal.
Tonight, the first ever Brit icon, Sir Elton John.
He is Elton John. That's what makes him an icon.
Welcome to the first ever Brits Icon Award. We are here to honour music royalty. Tonight, we're going to be hearing classics, exclusive new songs, and chatting with the only British artist the first award could possibly go to. Ladies and gentlemen, Sir Elton John. You've won and done everything there is to do in music. You know, you've won so many awards. This is the first award of its kind.
Listen, I'm extremely flattered, and you know, I'll take what I can get at my age. Thank you very much.
All right. Okay. Now, Elton's been making music for over 50 years, which I'm sure he's thrilled to be reminded of. That's an awful lot to get through. So hold tight as we look back how it all began.
I don't think to this day that Reg Dwight would probably have been as successful as Elton John.
Who is this Elton John?
Elton was naturally musical. 4.5-year-old boy that sits down and plays the Skater's Waltz from ear, having never learned to play a piano. That's something very special right there. His mother was a great lover of rock and roll. She's the one that brought the Elvis Presley records in and opened Elton's eyes to this whole new world of music.
He'd been in bluesology, he'd been at the Royal Academy. He was taking with him a classical world, a jazz world, and all these musical references were brewing.
But we can never forget Bernie.
When we first met, I mean, we were joined at the hip. I just liked him. I just thought he was a really nice guy.
I'm not one of those who can easily hide.
Elton went into a music publishing company in Soho, and listen, I think I can write melodies, but I can't really write lyrics.
I had to go and meet him at a recording session. I felt very out of place. Somebody actually said, are you supposed to be here? You know, I felt this small.
He and Bernie, they used to do demo after demo after demo. It was getting to them.
We were very much feeling our way in the early days. I didn't know anything about songwriting, so the only idea in my mind was just to write some lyrics out. He worked with them, and from then on, it just, that's it.
The fact that, you know, from that one chance encounter, they can go on to be one of the greatest songwriting teams in history, that's kismet.
People would say, we heard Elton John play the piano, we haven't heard it played quite like that before. It's new material. No one had done anything quite like this before. It wasn't fully rock and roll, it was Elton John.
So, let's go back to where it all began. Your history teacher wrote in your report, you'll either be some sort of glorified office boy or a millionaire. When did you know you were definitely going to be a musician?
When I was at grammar school, I got 5 O-levels, but I didn't work very hard because I was already in a kind of semi-professional band. Music was my life. I wanted to do that. I grew up in the 50s, and it was a difficult time after the war, so my parents wanted me to have a steady job, and that's very understandable. But I didn't want to be a banker. I didn't want to be in the Air Force. I wanted to play music. And as soon as I heard Little Richard and Jerry Lee Lewis and Elvis Presley, that changed the world, not just me. It changed the whole world. That was when I realized you could play the piano in a different way. Up to that point, it'd been... And then suddenly it was... And I know which one I prefer.
And when you did decide to go for it with music, you know, you left school before taking A-levels. We've got the original NME ad here that you answered. I don't know if you've seen this. Does that feel, you know, you and Bernie answered that there, right?
Why I answered this ad is because I was fed up with playing to cabaret music with people in fish and chips and chicken in a basket. And I thought there's got to be more to music than this. And I was very insecure, very kind of overweight, plump, very shy. And I thought, you know what, I'm going to go for it. And the rest is history. You know, I'm a great believer in fate. If I hadn't have taken the chance and answered that ad, I would never have met Bernie.
Well, let's talk Bernie, because you've been going for 50 years, but you've never worked in the same room together, is that right?
We've never worked in the same room. We've never had an argument.
But when he first moved down, he lived with you and your mum, right?
Right, yeah.
But he was working in one room and you were working in another room?
Yeah, I mean...
And did you ever just peer your head around and go, what are you up to? Did a hand, what are you up to?
Well, listen, I'll tell you, this next song I'm going to play, we'd made one record called Empty Sky, which was an album, and we were very happy with it. And then one day, he came to me and he gave me a lyric and said, this one, see what you can do with this one. So I closed the door, he went back to the bedroom, I went into the living room, sat at the upright piano, read the lyric through, and I went, oh, my God. I was astonished that an 18-year-old boy could write something like this, so mature and so old for his age. And that's Bernie's story for the whole of his lyric writing. And this is the song that changed our career and our lives.
Ready for it?
Yeah.
Okay, great stuff. Well, it's going to do us the honour, ladies and gentlemen. Elton John and your song.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I'm not one of those who can easily hide. I don't have much money. Boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I was a sculptor, but then again, no. Or a man who makes potions in a traveling show. I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, and this one's for you. And you can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, hope you don't mind that I'm putting down in words how wonderful life is while you're in the world. Out the bars with a few of the verses, oh, they got me quite cry. But there's something quite kind. Well, I wrote that song, it's for people like you that keep it turned on. So excuse me for getting I do. You see, I've forgotten if they're green or they're blue. Anyway, the things what I really mean. Oh, yours are the sweetest eyes I've ever seen. And you can tell everybody.
Plus, with a very special guest appearance from my very special guest, Mr. Richard. Welcome back. We're celebrating the first ever Brits Icon, Elton John. All right, having cracked the UK, the goal of most British stars is to cross the Atlantic and break America. But unconventional as ever, Elton went and did it the other way round.
Elton was desperate to go to America because all of the music that he loved was created in America.
Troubadour was the place that you played in Los Angeles.
They employ young bands that are coming on. And when Elton played, that's what he was. You know, he's trying to break America.
It's a tiny club. Thousands of people claim to have been in the room on that night, when in fact it was really only a small handful. That's when the journey began.
That was it. He went to Hollywood, boom.
By November, he was the biggest star in America.
It was amazing how the Elton mania just continued to grow.
We were one of the first acts of that era to start playing stadiums. I remember when
a rock was down. To do the Hollywood Bowl was a major privilege. You know, who played the Hollywood Bowl rock and roll wise before us? I mean, hardly anybody.
Dodger Stadium was just amazing.
It's Billie Jean King.
He's got a sequin uniform on that was absolutely adorable. I love that uniform. These are memories that I'll have forever.
The greatest ever Elton concert was the Madison Square Garden concert with John Lennon.
Elton had done Whatever Gets You Through the Night, a single with John. He made a bet with John and he said, look, if that song goes to number one, you have to get on stage with us at Madison Square Garden. Whatever gets
you through the night. Did get to number one. So he goes, does that mean I've got to do it? So I said, well, you did say you would.
And of course, when he came on stage, the ovation he received was just insane.
John started to sing. I was just suddenly got very emotional.
And the whole building was shaking like there was an earthquake.
The concert hall was just vibrating. Incredible.
Afterwards, when John came off stage, he said to me, that was great. Fill in the blank.
Okay, you saw that. One performance in a tiny club, a very famous club called the Troubadour, can change everything. Were you surprised that America did take you to its heart so quickly?
All the great British entertainers of that time, Mark Bolan, Rod Stewart, the Rolling Stones, David Bowie, and later on Freddie Mercury, The Who, they were all theatrical. American bands didn't really get dressed up. The Beach Boys never got dressed up. You know, we were something different. We came from a vaudeville background, and I think that influenced what we did. For me, I can't just go on in a shirt and jeans because, A, I'm too fat to wear jeans, and, B, I wouldn't feel like doing that. I have to get into costume. You gotta get ready for the occasion. Playing on stage, whether you're playing to 200 people or 100,000 people, is an occasion, and you should treat it as an occasion, and you should treat your audience like that. For me, I have to get into costume, you know?
And look, America went so wrong for you and so right for you, you know? Obviously, with the right, you become the, you know, one of the biggest stars in the world, but it went wrong in terms of, you know, the addiction and suicide and the was it just the pressure of all of this?
Listen, when I happened in 1970, for the next 5 or 6 years, I just did nothing really but work. And you do pay a price because the personal side of your life gets dragged back. And also, I was very, very confident of being Elton John on stage, but I was still a little boy who became Elton John off stage. And there was a huge imbalance in my life.
I don't want to make light of it, but even your suicide attempt had the touch of the theatrical about it, okay? 60 yeah. Valium tablets, jumping the swimming pool in front of your mum and your gran.
Yeah. My grandmother said, oh, well, we might as well bleed and we'll go home now. you know, I'm all mouth and no trousers. It was a cry for help. It was before Dodger Stadium. It was a stupid thing to do. I've never been very good at asking for help. I've never been good at expressing how I'm feeling, whether it's physically or emotionally. So I did that, which was a very stupid and selfish thing to do. And I did that repeatedly during my drug addiction days and my drinking. So when I actually said, all right, I need help, and I was confronted, then my whole life came together straight away. And I've been 23 years clean now, and I can't believe that. I cannot believe that I was so stupid.
Okay, we're going to hear some more music now, and you wrote Philadelphia Freedom for Billie Jean King and her tennis team. Let's hear how that came about.
Elton loves tennis, so he used to come and watch me and the Philadelphia Freedoms when we had our matches. He's like, I want to write a song for you. How about if we call it Philadelphia Freedom after the team? I said, well, that'd be a great gift to the people of Philadelphia if you want to do that. That would be unbelievable. He was so funny. He says, when I go, Philadelphia, that's you getting upset with an umpire. I said, what? Every time I hear Philadelphia Freedom, those memories flood back in my mind of how kind to do something so generous for me and for the Philadelphia people.
Ah!
find an Elton on the road. You have to be a heartbeat for somebody, but not the time it takes to let the day before my work get done. Let me be the fiddle of death, the freedom, yeah. Dead and I was born with the flag. Fiddle of death, the freedom, just beneath my two-way man. Oh, yeah. You believe that not my daddy never had.
Oh, the way that I wonderful back there.
jet.
More classic, it's brand new songs. And the biggest names in music reveal what Elton's really like to work with. My money is on a total sweetheart. We'll see you shortly. Highest honour in British music, only presented to artists who made a lasting impact on music and British culture. Now, we've been in Elton's company for roughly half an hour. No tantrums, no strops.
Yeah.
God, those eyes. Hasn't been difficult in any way at all. I'm sure the experience is the same with all the artists he's worked with over the years. Let's find out.
Right, Clive, roll the tape, will you?
When you meet powerhouses, you know it.
I promise you don't want to know what he's really like.
There was never a dull moment living with him, ever.
He has his crazy moments, his self-centered moments, and he has his loving and giving and kind moments.
He's a diva, in the best sense of the word.
He's known for pulling these tantrums, but most of the tantrums have been for good reason.
Listen, I got up 7 o'clock in the morning to get here, and I'm
with Elton, it's all out there. I think that's part of his charm.
I hate you, they're both of them. And I tell you this, I am not doing this video.
Elton, that's one of the best sense of humor in the whole world.
You bore awfully easy.
Oh, terribly, yeah.
He's not averse to a little jocularity.
Say your love, my darling.
The writing team were in our 45th year, I believe. So I think that really says it all.
And without Bernie, there wouldn't be any songs anyway.
So, your reputation precedes you, Mr. John. And is that person we saw in Tantrums and Tiaras still the same person now? Are you changed now you're a father?
We're all, as artists, flawed. We're all monsters at some times. And I just thought it was very funny the way I behaved. It wasn't very funny to the people around me, but I had a good laugh at it. For example, I said, I'm never going to the south of France again. The next year, I bought a house there. I mean, that's just... But my partner has helped me. He's confronted me on issues that, you know, needed to be confronted. And, you know, he's really helped me become a different person. Having the children is just the icing on the cake. I mean, you have to behave yourself around. You can't swear. You can't do this because it's going to affect their behavior. And, of course, that's the best thing that's ever happened to me in my life. But my partner is damn near that because he's been with me nearly 20 years this year. And he's helped me. He's helped me confront those little demons of mine, which I, you know, is still in me, and they can, you know, they can happen, but they don't happen very often.
Oh, thank God. But what happens when the boys throw tantrums? There's a little part, tiny little part of you go, that's my boy. Like, so, you know, turn them off, and then you come around the corner and go, Christ, he's got it.
I don't really tell them off, you know. They're kids, they're 2.5 years old, what do you expect?
Yeah,
you know?
That's now.
They have discipline.
That's now. When you don't have a leg to stand on is when they come in drunk and 15. You go, don't drink.
Right.
Yeah, all right. Yeah. Don't do drugs.
You did drugs. By that time, I'll be on a Stana chairlift.
Being a diva, or being called a diva, do you think it's crucial? Is perfectionism just honesty?
I'm not a diva anymore. I know what I like, and I like to get it right. And I like things a certain way, but it's called professionalism, I think. My band are professional, we're professional, we always turn up on time, we're never late, we have a conscience.
There's a responsibility there.
A responsibility, yeah, and that's the way my children are going to be brought up too.
I imagine one of the most pleasing things for you is how, you know, over the years you've acquired a new generation of fans, be that The Lion King, be that Billy Elliot, be that a collaboration with Eminem or Ed Sheeran. I mean, how does it feel that new generations are growing up with your music, whether that's finding it themselves or through their parents?
There's a lot of people can't stand my music, and that's okay.
They're not here.
Yeah, but for me, I thrive on the young. I thrive on the new talent. There's something about young people that is an energy that you had in your 20s. It's called adrenaline. And when you hear something brilliant by somebody new, it really inspires you. I know the old, and a lot of my peers prefer the old, but I prefer the new.
Do you think that keeps you young?
Of course it does. Yeah. I mean, I still have a lot of energy, and I still have a lot of passion, but it's a different sort of thing when you're 22, 23. So that's why I like to feed off.
It's testosterone.
I'm a vampire, yeah.
Listen, we're going to get onto one song now that's probably going to go down quite well tonight, I would say. This is Tiny Dancer.
Blue jean baby, LA lady, seems it's for the band. Pretty eyed,
look backwards, we look forwards and sideways at how Elton has influenced the music industry of today, and he proves there's still plenty of life in the old-ish dog as he performs a song from his new album. We'll see you in a bit. Icon with the one and only Elton John. Now, most people's musical tastes become more entrenched as I get older, but not Elton's. He loves, he champions new music. For a young artist, getting Elton's seal of approval is like being taken under the wing of an outrageously dressed godfather. Let's take a look at how he's influenced and supported the stars of today.
I started to play the piano because of one person, Elton John.
He likes celebrating young success.
He has been hugely responsible for creating my own musical diversity.
When I first covered your song, I didn't really think about the impact of it. It was almost like a game changer, really.
Not only has he been a great artist, he's been great for helping other musicians. What do I do
to make you love me? He crosses through all these years.
He loves it when people are innovative and different. I think that's just really cool.
There's a lot more life in the old girl yet.
He's the Energizer Bunny, man.
He knows every new record that's coming out. He listens to every new record that's coming out.
He's just an encyclopedia for music.
Always wants to know what's next, who's next, where's next.
Whether it's a Bewitched CD or whether it's Jake Bugg or whoever, he buys everything, he listens to it, and if he appreciates it, he'll ring someone up and tell them that he likes it.
I get this call, and I can't really hear who it is. All the music's blaring out, and I'm just like, it's Ben Elton. And I'm like, Ben, why is Ben Elton calling me? And he says, Ben, it's Elton, Elton John. So then I'm like...
We couldn't believe that he enjoyed listening to our music and he was supporting us. It's like the sun going down.
Elton is an enthusiast. If he sees that talent, he just goes wild for it. He's a huge fan.
He is one of those people that you look up to. He's like a giant, colossus in some way.
Elton's been probably the most supportive person in my career. I got nominated for a Grammy, and I got a phone call from him, and he was like, so do you want to play with me? When we were rehearsing, we're playing my tune, so he wants to know how to play it. How can I tell Elton John how to sing a song? Like, he's Elton John. It's too cold. By the end of it, I was like, no, that's wrong, you do it like this and do it like that. He was kind of like, I'm glad you did that. I hate it when people are too polite. You just get to the point.
As long as there's new music out there to listen to and to discover and to appreciate, he'll be there.
I just love the fact that Plan B thought Ben Elton was giving him a call there. Did you ever think how weird it is when your phone goes and you're a young musician and they pick it up and it's Elton John on the other end of the phone?
Well, of course it is, but it's really important to do that because when I first started in America, and I had a telegram from George Harrison saying, congratulations, the record's fantastic. You know how much that means to someone who's young and coming up? It means a validation of your work. It's one of your heroes in life, in musical life. And Neil Diamond introduced me on stage at the Troubadour when I first went to America because he wanted to, because he liked the album. To have that validation is so important because it means for an artist when you're young that you are doing something right.
Now, we're all young and outspoken once. There's a few things I want to ask you about. When you were 34, you said, when I'm 40, I don't want to be charging around the country doing concerts. I'd rather retire gracefully. Hello.
That shows you what a twat I am. I have to say that now I've had this illness, I don't have to play, you know, 120 shows a year. I'm addicted to playing live. I have a list of 100 countries I want to play. Why? Do you have to, you know, I'm not going to go at the end of my life and say, someone says, oh, by the way, you missed out one country, you can't come in. It's just the way my brain thinks. I've played every state in America, every province in Canada. I've played 92 countries, and I just want to play 100. That's the way I am. I'm sort of programmed to work.
All right, you also said a few years back about having kids. I'm too old for this. I don't want to be 70 years old with a teenage child. Unlucky man.
Well, I won't be 70 years old with a teenager. I'll be 80 years old with a teenager.
I'm too selfish, I'm too set in my ways. What changed?
It was a little boy in an orphanage in Kiev, in the Ukraine. I went there with the AIDS Foundation, and this one little boy called Lev gravitated towards me the whole time, and I held him in my arms for about an hour, and he was just the most magical thing. So 3 years ago, David sat me down and said, listen, what about having our own child through a surrogate? And I went, you know, I've always said no, but this little boy, Lev, was trying to tell me something. He was saying, you're not too set in your ways. You can give a lot of love to your child. And I said, if I don't take notice of what this little boy was trying to tell me, then I'll always regret it. And that little boy was responsible for us having Zachary and Elijah. And that's why Zachary's name is Levon, the third name, because he's named after Lev. And it's due to that little boy in Ukraine.
Okay, listen. You started having piano lessons with a child at the Royal Academy. This has almost gone full circle. You're working with them again, aren't you?
I love the Royal Academy of Music. I'm a member of the Royal Academy of Music. I'm a doctor of music. I'm so glad of the legacy that I have with it. Ray Cooper, my wonderful percussionist, and I did two concerts, and we paid for a brand new organ for them, because the other one was awful. And that's going to be unveiled. My new organ is going to be unveiled in October. But it's a huge love affair I have with them.
Okay. Here to accompany Elton as he plays a single from his new album, Diving Board, is a choir and brass section made up of students from the Royal Academy. This is Home Again.
Get me out of here. I'm waiting for the fog around this spooky little town to clear. All this time I've been being someone else's friend. Just one more time, for all time's sake, I'd like to go back home again. The world at seven wonders, once upon a time, sure enough the favored nations aided their decline. And all around me I've seen times like it was back when. But like back then, I'd say amen if I could get back home again. If I could go back home, if I could go back home, if I never loved, I never had known. We all dream of leaving, but wind up in the end. Spend out all our time trying to get. Spotlight hitting me. Or was I just some nightclub singer back in 1963? In the old part of Valencia on the coast of Spain. Never tired once of hearing songs about going home again. We are dreaming of living.
going to make two more classic hits. Plus, we see Elton as Donald Duck and more reassuringly as the Rocket Man. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to a nice celebration with Brit Icon Elton John. Now, when you think of Elton, you think of, course, legendary music, large and life personality, but frankly, an understated and quite boring wardrobe. Every now and again, however, he likes to slip into something a little bit more razzy and let the world know that a true showman has entered the room.
Elton was always slightly flamboyant from day one.
Instead of one trunk for his clothes, he started having six or seven, and then he got bigger and bigger, and clothes got more expansive.
As a child, he felt quite stifled growing up. I don't think he was really allowed to express himself. I think he had to dress a certain way, he had to behave a certain way. His parents were quite strict.
I never had a pair of roller skates till I was 23.
The whole showmanship aspect of Elton was a backlash against that.
Rock and roll was just a passport and a way for him to completely reinvent himself and turn himself from Reginald Dwight, which he didn't think was very cool, into this fantastic new creature called Elton John.
The shows were getting more and more and more elaborate, and the audiences were loving it.
I just think Elton got the costume bug, big time. Once he realised that that's what he was doing, he couldn't stop doing it.
He just never knew what to expect.
Probably if I had those costumes now, they'd go in the fireplace. And there'd be a very happy smile on my face.
He is a showman. That is secondary to his musicianship, his performance, the songs.
On one hand, it's the fashion, but I think people forget what an amazing musician he is.
He's an absolute virtuoso on the piano.
He was a rock and roll star who was playing piano, kicking the stool away and jumping up and screaming at people, you know, like, what the hell's this? You know, this guy's nuts.
I have seen a lot of his older performances and just thought, wow.
He's one of a kind.
Yeah, he's a Liberace of rock, isn't he?
Let's talk clubber. What was the toughest outfit to play piano in?
The Donald Duck outfit. I didn't do a trial run. I came off stage at Central Park and I put my legs through the armholes, my arms through the leg holes, and it had this enormous bum on it. And so when I'm sitting on the piano, I don't have any room to play the piano. And they were difficult outfits. They were very heavy. I remember the first electronic pair of glasses ever made were the Elton John and Elton glasses, and they were huge, and it had a battery pack about the size of a microwave oven. And when I came on stage, they said, what's my life like this? So I used to sing Funeral Friend and Love Life Bleeding like that. But anything for the showmanship part, yeah.
At the start, was a costume there to hide what you were... What
no,
you were...
I liked dressing up. You know, I just, as I said earlier in the programme, it was part of the ritual. I carried it way, way too far. But, you know, can't have one bunch of flowers, can't have one car. You know, it's part of my personality. I didn't know when to stop.
Listen, we're going to have time for some more music now. It's one of his all-time classics. This is Rocket Man.
She packed my bags last night before I 0 hour 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. I miss the earth so much. I miss my wife. It's lonely out in space. I'm such a time. Let's fly. And I think it's gonna be a long time. We'll touch it down, bring it around and get a fire. I'm not the man that they got on my own. Oh, I'm a rocket man.
Tonight's show, we have an exclusive Never Been Seen Before collaboration between Elton and someone he likes to call Chris. We'll see you shortly. Welcome back. We've been celebrating the life and career of the first ever Brit Icon, Elton John, who ever the magpie has been itching to get his hands on the actual award. Well, this is it. Time to make the presentation. After we've reminded ourselves why he's getting this accolade.
A nostalgic piece. Rather like me, really.
I just think he's extraordinary. One of a kind.
Just had a love for the craft, and he's one of the masters.
Closest thing you're going to get to royalty that isn't royalty. And that's what makes him iconic.
He's the King and Queen of England.
He's continued to do it again and again and again. Regardless of the time, he's exciting.
Isn't exciting, folks?
Sir Elton John, I mean, of course he's a Brit icon.
He's been called much worse.
When your music's that good and you're that talented, the world's gonna love you.
He's like literally the opposite to Flash in the Pan.
He's not an icon, who he is?
In addition to being a fabulous musician, he's a world-class human being and an unbelievable philanthropist.
I don't know yet if people fully understand how significant he is in terms of HIV and AIDS, saving lives. It's just breathtaking.
He has provided a soundtrack to people's lives.
He really epitomizes the word icon.
Thanks for all the loyalty you've shown me. Thank you, really, it means a lot. Now piss off.
So, to present the first ever Brit Icon Award, a man who at various times Elton has described as the best singer I've heard in rock and roll, bar none, and Phyllis.
Please welcome
Rod Stewart.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, the moment you've all been waiting for, the end of the show. It's my great honour to present the award to someone I've had the privilege to know for nearly 50 years. I don't think there's anybody I would have travelled all around the world, which I did from Los Angeles last night, that's why I've got no voice, than to be with my old mate and give him this award. As you know, we go back a long way. We both had our checkered past, and you can read about that in my autobiography called Rod. Hold on, I'm not finished. So, to one of my dear mates, and I wish I saw a lot more of him, but I live over there, and he lives there, Elton John, Sir Elton John.
First of all, I'd like to thank Rod. We go back a long way. We've made it at the same time. He was a little ahead of me, and we've been rivals and competitors ever since in a really good-natured way. For example, once he was playing at Earl's Court, and he had a big balloon above Earl's Court promoting his record and everything, and I had it shot down. I phoned him at the hotel. I said, you know that balloon you got? Can you still see it out your window? And he said, no. And then I played Olympia, and I guarantee you, I had a sign across the road saying, Elton John, Olympia. It was up for 2 minutes. And it was hacked down. And it's all been done in love and fun. And he is, for me, the greatest singer that rock and roll has ever had. So... I'd like to thank the Brit people for bestowing this unbelievable honour ahead of so many other people I can think deserved it more. But mostly to Bernie Taupin, who I wouldn't be here without. And to you, the fans. It wouldn't have been the ride that it's been without the fans. Thank you so much. They've even made it sparkly at the bottom.
Well, that's just about it. But to play us out, they've been mates for years, and now we finally get to hear them sing together with sad songs say so much. It's Rod Stewart and Brit's icon, Mr. Elton John. Good night. Yeah.
Share a little pain out and out the road, but
feel so good to hurt so bad and suffer just enough to send a move. Turn them out, turn them out, turn on those lights off.
Say that song.